graphic design, but rather communication design. It's really about exhibitions. I've been at MoMA for 23 years, and during these 23 years, I have proposed exhibitions and ideas that have been rejected. We all deal with a lot of rejection in our jobs, and I'm sure that you're familiar with it. But then in some cases, ideas were accepted even though they were irritating. And in keeping with the theme of this Congress, of this conference, which is forward, these irritations have been able to push things just a little forward for the museum and also for myself. And that's what I would like to tell you about tonight. So this is what the collection of design of the museum traditionally looks like in people's minds. You know, there are six departments. Architecture and design is one of them. And the museum exists since 1929, and we've been collecting a lot of your classic design objects, furniture, sometimes motorcycles and cars, posters, your usual, albeit wonderful, design items. But in the past few years, we also started collecting more unusual, at least for the normal audience, not for you, types of design. We've been starting to collect interactive design, we started to collect video games, we started collecting all sorts of digital kind of design that was unfamiliar for some of our audience and certainly for some of our trustees also. For instance, we started collecting speculative design. Here in Vienna at the Angewandte, Fiona Raby was one of the biggest teachers, and she's kind of the mother of critical design. And this is one of the objects by Tony Dunn and Fiona Raby that are in the collection. It's called Foragers, and it's this idea of a future in which there would not be enough food for everyone, so we have to go back as a human species digesting foods that we have not touched in centuries, and so our stomachs have become delicate. So roots, leaves, seaweed, and Tony and Fiona are hypothesizing this outsourced gastrointestinal systems that can eat those and pre-digest those foods for us. And you see them here worn by some very generous French students in the French countryside. And these are part of the MoMA collection. Or we started also acquiring biodesign. This is a virus. It's your typical bacteriophage virus that is used all the time in experiments, but in this case, it's designed using software, a software that is being produced by Autodesk, and you're all familiar with Autodesk. They've been doing AutoCAD and 3D printing programs forever, and now they're tackling biology. And we acquired the virus by acquiring a 3D printed model as if it were architecture. Or we've been acquiring apps. You know, the first app that we acquired was Biophilia by Bjork. Actually, not really. The first app that we acquired were John Maeda's reactive books. The reactive books that he designed in the early, I think it was 1994, and then again in the early 2000s, that are contained little programs that could be used at that time. And then we collected data visualization, of course, computerized data visualization, but also drawn by hand. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Stephanie Posavec and Georgia Lupi. They're two wonderful visualization designers. One lives in New York, Georgia. The other lives in London, Stephanie. They met at a conference and they decided they wanted to become friends and get to know more about each other. So for a whole year, they sent each other postcards, hand-drawn postcards, that had a data visualization of something about the week that passed, how many times they had a glass of wine, or how many times they said fuck, or you know what I'm saying? So just this kind of exchange, or how many friends they had seen, and you see how beautifully drawn they are. So we acquired also these in the MoMA collection, besides having acquired many visualizations. And then we started acquiring video games. This was a big brouhaha. We started acquiring it about 3 years ago. And I didn't expect the reaction, but you know, it's kind of normal. The motto of the museum is that it exists to document and to praise the art of our time. So MoMA was founded in 1929 by three ladies from the New York Society that wanted a place where they could show the art of our time. Their husbands were collecting Rembrandts and Rubenses. They wanted to show Picasso and Matisse, maybe some Impressionists. And so they went to a director, Alfred Barr, the one was in his late 20s, and they founded the museum. And since the beginning, the director, who had been influenced by the Bauhaus, thought that it was about all the arts of our time coming together to make a better world. So when we think of the art of our times, video games, of course, are one of the most important expressions, as is digital interaction design and data visualization. But I remember when we announced these video games, the first were 14 and then 7 more, there was a real visceral reaction on the side of a very conservative part of the public against it. And I was surprised by it, but I realized that as the technology changes, art and design change with it, but sometimes people don't. And this is how the museum looks right now. You know, you see this is a reflection of the garden with the third floor with architecture and design. Actually, I'm sorry, this is from a few months ago. You see the acquisition. We have acquired the on-off sign. We have acquired the Google Map pin. And one of my proudest acquisitions is the at sign, and we can talk about it more later. Lately, we also acquired the first set of emojis from 1999, and it's been a wonderful installation in the lobby of the museum, and it's been great to see how people are getting with the program. And what I would like to tell you about tonight is how, as a curator in a big museum, you can push things a little forward by creating programs and projects that are not really orthodox, but that are valves of expression, not only for the curator, but also for the audience. About 4 years ago, I founded a department of research and development, and you see here that research is big and development is small because we do a lot of research and very little development. And actually, an old colleague of mine, Alina Resende, lives here in Vienna now, but she was one of the pioneering research assistants for this small department. The idea came during the 2008 financial crisis. We're all creatives here, and we know how little intellectual and creative labor is valued in the world. We see the financial sector just like ratcheting up money, while we have to always make people understand that we're not priests and angels, that we also eat and that our work has value. So in 2008, when finally the financial sector showed its real colors, I saw an opportunity for the museum to really show that museums can be the R&D of society, and I told the director, but of course at that time we were all taking pay cuts so that nobody had to be fired, so it was not a good moment to start a new department. And we did a few years later, and the department really studies what the museum can contribute when society has to tackle important issues, issues that are sometimes existential, other times just procedural. And what we do is we have these great salons, one every other month, more or less, that are on themes like death or algorithms or too many conferences. So you see, it's kind of haphazard. But what we try to do is we try to bring together very different perspectives, have, as usual, usually at least one artist, but not always, and make an introduction at the beginning and then have a great discussion. And when people RSVP yes, they get a reading list. And I've discovered that when you ask people to do some homework, they enjoy themselves much more. It's a secret that I learned. But it all comes from the basics of the science of new museology. It's not a science, it's a study, but it's the idea that in the past, old museums used to be about preservation and protection of material heritage, and instead, new museums help people cope with their life, with everyday life. They help people advance. They are educational institutions that are not only about imparting notions, but rather they're about imparting people tools to live, tools to be more critical. And that's how I see my role. I see my role not in telling people what's good design, that's very old school, but rather it's about helping people create their own criteria to then make their own opinions about what good design is. Of course, there are some universal bases, you know, responsibility, sustainability, some measurable, objective ideas, but then there are so many others that are personal, and I want people to understand that design is for them. You can look at these slides for hours, so I'm gonna move on to just talking about the crisis of museums today. You see, right now, museums are remaining at a level of diversity and a level of eclecticism that reflects the population of the first part of the 20th century. Populations are changing. Immigration, diversification, fluidity, there are so many different ways in which the world is changing, our audiences are changing, and I think that museums have to change too. So, the salons are, for instance, there was a beautiful salon about algorithms. It was called The Way of Algorithm. And we had to talk about it, a great artist, Heather Dewey Hagborg. You might know her because she reconstructed the faces and features of people from cigarette butts that she found in the streets in Dublin. Hugo Liu, who's a wonderful trend forecaster, Claudia Perlich, who's a data scientist, and then Adam Bly, who wrote the algorithm for many different companies, including Spotify. So the discussion was not about the usual big data algorithm, we've heard it so many times. No, it was much more sophisticated. It was about human intervention. It was about humans correcting the algorithm and showing how that balance is really the way of the future. Another great salon was about fluidity. We talk about it so much, but what does it really mean to accept fluidity and to reflect fluidity in a museum that wants to deal with the art of our time and that wants to help people live their everyday lives? And hybridity, slightly different, but in the same vein, was another salon. Hybrid individuals, T-shaped individuals. How many times have we heard about it? How is that really something that can be fostered and disseminated to wider audiences? You'll like this. The day before the US election, I ran a salon about the informed future. How sad and how sarcastic, perhaps, ironic for sure. And it was a beautiful salon, and it was done on purpose the day before the election to kind of prepare all of us and inoculate all of us to what the future could be. And we had wonderful people to talk about it. We had Georgia, the data visualization designer that I mentioned before, two futurists, Amy Webb and Ari Wallach, one very much involved in politics in Washington and the other instead more involved in style, and then Itasha Womack, who's an Afrofuturist. It was a beautiful discussion and bittersweet because nobody mentioned the elections, but people already had a sense of what could happen. And of course, right after the election, I had a salon on death, because that's how we were all feeling. But it was a beautiful discussion, because there's so much that we're studying about death right now. There are so many designers that are studying both the before, the during, and the after death as an issue that really needs to be tackled in a holistic way, not just in a functional way. And the speakers at that time were an ethicist, Francis Kamm, then an art critic, Allison, that also works as a tour guide to burial grounds, and Rita Sharon, who's the founder of the Narrative Medicine Department at Columbia University, and Carla Rothstein, who's the founder of the Death Lab at Columbia that studies, Columbia University also, that studies how to integrate cemetery and burial grounds within cities when space is running out and humans and living humans want to live more with their dear dead ones. The last salon that we had just recently was about truth. There's been so much talk about a post-truth world, about fake news, about alternative facts, that was the best one. So we really wanted to talk about truth and to understand what truth can be today. And in that case, we had an astrophysicist, a great blogger, a journalist from Al Jazeera, a political diplomat, a digital diplomat expert, and a philosopher. So you can tell there's a lot of diversity of opinions, and there's a lot of diversity of ideas that get discussed. And after 2 hours of discussion, we go on for another 2 hours of drinks. And believe it or not, I mean, New Yorkers are quite amazing, but they usually stay. Everybody stays until the end, and people keep talking. That's all it takes sometimes for museums to be active in the world, is just to give the stimulus for people to be able to speak, to give the place, to give the impetus. And sometimes we can also do without galleries. Design and Violence is a very interesting project that did not ever become an exhibition, at least not at the Museum of Modern Art. It all started with the 3D printed gun. I'm sure you're all familiar with it. It was a few years ago, I think 4 at this point. Cody Wilson, libertarian kind of philosopher thinker from Texas, decides to publish open source online files that enable anybody who has a decent printer, not a sophisticated one, a medium kind of level printer, to print a gun, a lethal gun that could shoot real bullets at home. I remember when this announcement came out, I was pretty stunned. I was stunned because all of a sudden, after having dedicated my whole life to this kind of Pollyannish pink idea that design and technology are for the good of the people, I was shown the exact opposite, or at least an appearance of the opposite. So I was stunned, and then 5 minutes later, I was angry at myself for being so surprised. Because of course, anything that we do as human beings can go either way, whether we want it or not. So I had to consider rethinking my position about design and being a little more nuanced rather than so black and white. Also at that time, there was a book that came out by Steven Pinker, who's a really great thinker from Harvard, that argued that our society is becoming less violent. I'm sorry, it really doesn't feel that way. So maybe it's the idea of violence that has changed. I decided, therefore, together with Jamer Hunt, a really great colleague, to try and understand how violence has changed in our society, and to do so by doing the only thing that I know how to do, looking at objects in order to understand people and the world. So we started making a list of objects that have an ambiguous relationship with violence, because they were designed for good and then they were turned around, or because they are impeccable designs for evil, or because they talk about situations that are ambiguous and violent. For instance, green bullets. Green bullets are being developed by several armies, including the US one. They are lead-free, so after you'll be dead, the environment will be safe. So there are these kind of strange ambiguities, or this beautiful poster by Volontaire, which is a Dutch company for Amnesty International, that talks about female genital mutilation in a way that is really strong, but at the same time is not overtly obscene, and therefore could be published even in Muslim countries with attention. Or, of course, James Bridle's Drone Shadow. I don't know how many of you are familiar with James's work, but the idea is to tape down on the ground the shadow of a lethal drone in countries that have never seen one before, to make people feel on their own skin in the West and in the Northern Hemisphere what it means to have drones that are hovering above you all the time. And he did one also in Washington, D.C. We presented this proposal to MoMA as an exhibition proposal. It was turned down. Let's not even go to the why, you know, who cares? It was turned down, it happens. So sometimes when you get rejections, you just throw away the idea. Other times you put it in a drawer and you wait for the right opportunity, but Jamer and I decided that in this case it was important to go ahead with this idea. It was urgent, we felt it in our stomach. So we did what one does when one doesn't have money and doesn't want to ask permission. We started a WordPress site. We started a WordPress site and we decided to publish one object every other week when we felt like it, right? We had a research assistant. Jamer is deputy provost at Parsons School of Design. We decided to just start out with an assistant, and every other week we would publish an object, And you see the range of objects was really wide, from prisons to anti-pirate cannons to the blue bra graffiti from the Arab Spring, so very wide. And every week we would have a little essay by somebody really authoritative. We called a few favors at the beginning, so we had Arianna Huffington and William Gibson, and then everybody followed suit. And after the essay, we would also ask a question to the public. So the box cutter that became the symbol of 9/11, the question was, which other invisible everyday objects can become lethal weapons? And so we had that. Is execution always ugly? Is euthanasia a form of violence or a form of compassion? These are serious questions. It's wonderful to be able to ask these questions from a position of authority like the Museum of Modern Art, because of course the museum saw that it was a good project and then called it into its own website. So we had amazing comments. When we published The Serpentine Ramp, the redesign of a slaughterhouse by Temple Grandin, we had about 150 comments. When we published this euthanasia coaster, which is a roller coaster that is supposed to deprive your head of oxygen, your brain of oxygen, until you're dead at the end, of course it's a speculative project. When we published this, we had a comment from somebody that is in eternal pain that said, you know, sometimes suicide is really the less pain. Of course, it's something that we know people think in their private moments, but not in a website run by a museum. So it was amazing to talk about this and to talk even about the death penalty. You must have heard that 2 days ago, the state of Arkansas put to death another inmate using midazolam, which is this medication. So the last post that ended the whole project was written by somebody who had been in death row for about 30 years before being let go because there was no proof, and actually he was completely innocent. At the end, MoMA did also a book about it, and we had great live debates about the theme of open source and the theme of empathy, the theme of eating animals, even open internet and how to keep it open, with great speakers like Larry Lessig and Biella Coleman, who's the foremost expert on Anonymous. But the wonderful thing is that at the end, an exhibition happened, but not at MoMA. It happened at the Science Gallery in Dublin. Because the people from the Science Gallery called me and said, can we have the show? And I said, there's no show, but how about you do the show? And they did a show, The Irish Know About Violence. There was like half of the material from the website and half their own material. And this is beautiful because says who that every curator has to do a show that's closed and closed and finished. We can start a chain reaction. And that's what I also would like to do with the next exhibition that we're preparing that will open at MoMA at the end of September. It's called Items, Is Fashion Modern? And it's about displaying and showing to people that what we wear has a lot of significance, much more than just how we look, but also it's a way to understand the world better, and it's a way to also have responsibility. The title comes from the only other show of fashion that MoMA ever did in 1944. It was a Viennese curator, Bernard Ludowski, a wonderful curator, that made this exhibition a very critical exhibition about the craziness of fashion at that time. It was Christian Dior's new look, so it was like squeezed waistlines and puffy skirts, and men used to wear all these layers of clothes, and bodies should have looked this way to match the clothes that were en vogue at that time. And that's what Rudofsky did with the sculptor. He showed what bodies should look like. So now, fashion has changed, it's much more open, but the system of fashion is equally irrational sometimes. So instead of talking about clothes, today we're talking about the fashion system. And modern means the same that the Forward Festival means being progressive, pushing forward, being constructive and optimistic. So when you see Dolce & Gabbana taking advantage of a whole new market by making this rather gaudy abayas, what do you think? And hijabs, what do you think? Is this modern or is this modern? This is Hana Tajima, who is Uniqlo's consultant for modest fashion. That's convinced Uniqlo to produce a series of hijabs that are still a little bit fast fashion. We'll get to that afterwards, but at least give different options and are differently engaged in society. Or Julia Machado, who you see on your right, who is a great blogger that is also on a wheelchair and also started becoming a model. She routinely goes down the runway. And it's wonderful to see that the fashion system can embrace this modern part. But when we see Rana Plaza, remember the Bangladeshi Dhaka-based factory that collapsed about 3 years ago and that killed more than 1,200 people? This is not modern, so the system of fashion needs to be reformed. And my belief is that I will never use the word consumers anymore because I really can't stand this idea of consuming, consumption, but people can really make a difference, also have an effect on this. And we've already started by rejecting some of the fashion that gets given to us. The exhibition will be 111 items of fashion and garments that have had a strong impact on the 20th and 21st century, from the chinos and the Havaianas to Alexander McQueen's armadillo shoes and to Le Smoking, from the keffiyeh to the Oxford shirt, and from the cheongsam and the hijabs and the Doc Martens to the little black dress. And they will all be shown as the stereotypes that made them famous in the 20th and 21st century. Of course, I know nothing about fashion, so the first thing that I did was to put together a really, really strong advisory group, not to mention a wonderful staff and wonderful team, and Michelle Fisher, and well, there are, Michelle Fisher is my right hand, but then we also gathered people that really know about fashion so we could do something serious there. So you might know some of the people here, like Penny Martin from The Gentlewoman and Imran Ahmed, the founder of Business of Fashion, Bandana Tiwari from Indian Vogue, and then Shane Oliver from Hood by Air. They've really been keeping us straight and helping us understand what to do with the exhibition. And last year we also had a wonderful public program that you can still find online. It was an ABC. We had 26 presentations from A to Z. Each one was 7 minutes. Each one was about an object or a theme, starting from the little black dress. Well, starting, no, we started with the A. Little black dress was in the middle. But that was one of them, or the H for hoodie. We had Duray McKesson, an activist from Black Lives Matter, and Kirby Jean-Raymond from Pierre Moss, a designer, make this amazing presentation about the hoodie and what it represents in society. Or U for unisex. What does unisex mean today? Once upon a time, it was about men and women wearing the same horrible clothes. Today, it's much more sophisticated, and we had Harry Neff, who's a transgender model, that actually talked about it. And we also will have some new versions of the old items. And for that, we're finding wonderful collaborators. Sartists is a collective from Johannesburg, and they are gonna tackle the chinos. They're gonna make new versions of the chinos for today. We're gonna have Lucy Jones, that is an expert in garments, cute, sexy, good garments for people on wheelchairs, that is actually gonna redesign the pantyhose so that also people on wheelchairs can wear it. And we're gonna have the new creative director of Marni that's gonna work on the Mao jacket, Verbal and Yoon from Japan that are gonna work on the Cartier Love bracelet, and Hana Tajima that's gonna work not on the hijab but on the turtleneck. We're gonna have even the ultimate little black dress designed by Pia Interlandi, who's a wonderful designer from Melbourne that works with people that are about to die. She designs the dress they wanna be buried in, and so that's the ultimate little black dress. We started a Medium publication, because of course, the research for this exhibition is amazing fun, and I have to say that the people in my team have produced really new research and new scholarly publications about it. So in the Medium publication, we try to talk about it as much as possible. I visited India and Bangladesh, and I went also to Rana Plaza, and Michelle went to Nigeria and South Africa. We went all around trying to understand better what the system of fashion is like. And the catalog is going to be, I think, equally interesting. It's going to go in strict alphabetical order, almost as if it were a Sears catalog. So you'll see we already have the little illustrations, and then we have the words and the text. And some of the entries will be slightly nostalgic because they represent a particular moment. Others, instead, will flow into our times. You see here the beret. It starts with two Basque peasants, and then it goes through Che Guevara and the Black Panther all the way to Beyoncé and to these wonderful girls from Oakland that are called the Radical Brownies. They are aged 7 to 12, and they want to tackle the world in the same way the Black Panthers did, but without the violence. Interspersed in this kind of catalog, an alphabetic catalog, will be five visual stories by five photographers. And it's really great because we took the whole list and we cut it in chunks as if it were a meatloaf, and we gave each chunk to each photographer. And it was alphabetical, so you didn't know what you would get. But I have to say, the results are fantastic. So we have Kristen Lee Moolman and IB Camera from South Africa, Bobby Doherty from New York, Catherine Losing from Germany, Omar Victor Diop from Senegal, and Monica Mogi from Japan. Very different ages, very different outlooks, and I'm very proud of what they produced. What it comes down to in the end is to really understand our position in society. I don't know if you've ever seen Juliana, this great artist that was here represented by another fellow artist in the Whitney Biennial about 4 years ago. But to me, this is really what I would like to show to the public of MoMA, a public that ranges between people that are very comfortable with a view like this, with an image like this, and people that instead really need to think about it longer. People that need to understand that creativity is not anymore just a moment, but needs to be fed. This is a beautiful diagram by Neri Oxman, who is a scientist, architect, and artist at the MIT Media Lab. Once upon a time, you used to look at diagrams that showed creativity interacting with technology and interacting with science, but here you see that it's a real cycle. They feed each other, not just interact. That's why it's called a Krebs cycle, because a Krebs cycle is the symbol of metabolism, defines metabolism. That's what I would like the museum to be able to expose to the public, and that's what I would like to really prompt. And if you want to follow and participate in this, these are all the different social media hashtags and handles. The Items MoMA hashtag is crossed out because a parasite is taking it over to show his work. So we're going to change, and I'll let you know soon what it'll be. But in the meantime, I hope that you'll be able to participate, because this museum and these curators are trying as much as possible to have a conversation and to show the vulnerability that comes from knowing that we're just reporting about the world as we see, but there are so many different ways to see it. Thank you very much.